I've been in the audience, backstage, smiling, sobbing, but I have this just warm feeling that together we can really, really make a difference, open doors, and create this better world for ourselves. So thank you once again for being here. A warm welcome to everyone who's watching this online. We are on this panel to widen the idea of gender at We The Women. The category of women is a very broad category, and it also includes trans women. And in this panel, we're going to talk about what it means to be a trans woman in India today, intersection between feminism and transgender rights, and the road ahead for trans women in an India which, you know, post 377, and after the passage of what we hope will be a good transgender right bill, although that's kind of in cold storage right now. So here to transform your lives and your imaginations, I have an incredible panel. To start off, I'd like to call the amazing Dr. Akai Padmashali, the founder of Ondede. Akai, welcome. Welcome. Next, I'd like to call Anubhuti Banerjee from Tata Steel, who's opening doors in corporate India for all of us. Anubhuti. And finally, the absolutely amazing Anandya Hajra, trans feminist, founder of the Pratyay Trust, all there from Calcutta. As you can see, they're all AAA, so we have an A team. And what we're going to do is we're going to start off with some questions, and then hopefully if we have some time, take some questions from the audience as well. Just to start off with, can you please share with all of us, what does it mean to be a trans woman in India today for each of you? If you could just share each of your own journeys and stories.
Wow. It's like that moment when we were waiting backstage, trying to open the door, knowing that most doors wouldn't have opened, but we're still keeping on trying. I think there is this reality that's staring at our face where 92%, according to the National Human Rights Commission survey, 92% of trans women or transgender persons are denied the right to any economic activity. So what we're looking really at is, we of course have the NALSA verdict by the Supreme Court of 2014. Great opportunity, but we're also sort of faced with the situation where we have a non-responsive state. So we know that the transgender bill is sort of almost put into cold storage. We really do not have a law. We have a judgment. But in the face of prejudice, in the face of centuries of discriminatory practices, how much does just a positive judgment help? The real change needs to happen on the ground, and policies need to be in place. So I'm in that, I think for me, yes, it's a moment in history, but I think we are yet to step out, if you ask me.
Thank you. Anubhuti, do you want to tell us what being trans means to you in the India of today?
Yes, it's a very huge question which has a lot of answers, because just like India is diverse, all the opinions on trans people are diverse. So for a trans woman specifically, there are a lot of roles that you're looked at into. For some people, you're a daughter. For some people, you're a speciality. For some people, you're a success story. For some people, you are just a problem maker who tries to achieve too much and much more than what they are allowed to have. For some people, you are love. For some people, you are that rare quantity which they'd be experiencing just once in their lifetime. So it's just so many boxes that you're put into, which you have to grow up with. And the first thing is, of course, what you see as yourself, and that is respect. So being a trans person in India is about being respected.
For me, I live in an undeclared emergency. Undeclared emergency. The public spaces and the spaces of activism are really shrinking. In the meantime, I'm proud to be for what I'm sitting today. And I am the Black Beauty. I'm very much comfortable about my identity. about my politics of sexuality and gender. I don't want to compromise because I'm not an antisocial element. I want to be part of this so-called larger society. But very unfortunate, the largest democracy has no space for little voices. And what is my government doing on this? What is my public doing on this? What is my society doing on this? I think now society also has the social responsibility, irrelevant of your background. Let's talk about the politics of humanity and social justice.
Thank you. Again, for each of you, building on what you just said, Akai, the politics of humanity and social justice, also the politics of feminism. So for each of you, you know, how does your trans identity intersect with feminism, both in your lives personally as well as in your work, if you could share? Anindya, I'm wondering if you want to take a stab at this first.
I think, like Akai ended, I think the idea of social justice, the idea of justice, social justice, economic justice, the idea of justice is fundamental. And I think that's where my feminist politics is rooted. And I think that's where I sort of cut across these otherwise quite divisive silos. I mean, we sort of work in these fragments. And I think sometimes I tell back home, I say, I don't want to work with trans people anymore. Probably my time is to talk to other movements, to other people's movements, to other justice movements. As a trans person, I'm not diluting my politics. All I want to do is I want to connect. I want to connect to other people's rights issues. There are issues of migration, there are issues of displacement, there are issues of the state coming down in terrible ways. Today, the question of dissenting voices, how you could be sort of branded an anti-national. I mean, you see, that is where I think my politics is rooted, and that's where I derive tremendous inspiration from as a trans feminist.
Excellent. Thank you, Anindya. Akai, do you want to follow up to that, if that's okay? Yeah.
I'm a human being first. Then I talk about all my activism, languages, feminism, feminist, etc. I'm not against a man or a woman who was born with penis and vagina. My feminism, I stand for who practice the power and patriarchy. My feminism has thought. My experience is a feminism experience. Yeah. You know, people can't be judged if you're majority in your cis-born sex or your gender-born sex. It's not about that. But feminism is something that, as I clearly said, it's about how do we understand one person's identity? How do you, you know, without discriminating on the, you know, like on the grounds of language, sex, sexuality, gender, whatever is concerned, but how do I practice that accepting the way people are? So I want to say this, judge not support gender identity, judge not support sexual diversity.
Thank you. Anubhuti.
I'd like to add to what the other speaker said. For me, feminism is not complete without transfeminism. And transgender experiences are not complete without feminism. I don't think either of these movements would have reached the stage that they are without each other. For example, if you say how the feminist movement helps a trans person, I'd give you a very personal example. I work in a manufacturing company, which is sadly a very male-dominated sort of a workplace. A movement started a few years back to increase diversity in the organization. Diversity in a way of including more women, including more representation of women, including more ideas of women, because a lot of our consumers in the future, in the present, are women. And if we keep our eyes closed right from the start of where we thought of thinking of our products as who their consumers will be, We cannot decide who they are going to be. So unless we have all these voices in there, in the pipeline, you will never figure out the best, the optimal product. Now what happened is that once the movement for diversity started, I found an immediate attachment to somewhere I could find a safe space. Now you might be working or be in a society which does not know a lot about trans feminism, but but there is a little bit of knowledge of feminism, at least. And that is where you're going to find your natural allies, people who have been, who have faced being marginalized for all their lives. They have the experiences, and with their words, with their experiences, you add on your experience. And that makes it a very powerful experience. Conversely, again, how does trans rights help feminism? I think we could have never understood the perspective of gender if we did not have people who were transitioning gender in their daily lives. Now, transitioning, I don't mean that transitioning from a zero to one, a point to point. Transition is something that we do in our daily lives. All of us transcend gender norms in some way or the other. And when we start questioning these gender norms, that is where trans feminism adds to feminism, and it gives us a flavor, it gives us a perspective which it could not have got otherwise. So that's why I think trans feminism and feminism could not exist without each other. I know there are people who would like to exclude both of them from each other, but I would say that is not the way forward, and that is going to be counterproductive for both of us.
Thank you. And not in this conference. This conference is about opening doors and transcending. And Anubhuti, I want to ask you a little bit more. You mentioned about your corporate experience. I don't know if you all know, but Anubhuti has her portrait up at the Tata headquarters. As far as I know, it's the only transgender person I know whose portrait is up at a major corporate headquarters. Tell us a little bit about this shift between when you started talking about your journey, your identity, and how you've helped one of India's oldest and largest corporates make this transition itself?
That's a very good question. I very recently visited the recently renovated Bombay House, which is the headquarters of the Tata Group. I had my portrait and my story just a few galleries away from the JRD Tatas and JN Tatas, and that was... That was probably one of the most empowering experiences that I had ever had, one of the most proudest experiences that I had ever had. Now, when I started this journey, I was in a place where I did not know if I would be able to complete this journey there. With every person who transitions or does not belong to the gender binary per se, they always question their surroundings. It's always... a question of whether you are in the wrong body or whether you're in the wrong society. So there's always this thing that you can either change the body or you can change the society. So I decided that I would like to do both. I would like to change the society, which for me, the immediate society was workplace, because I was dedicated to my workplace. I was in love with my workplace. It was a place which gave me a lot of freedom to do the things that I liked. So that's why I decided, why not? Why not try to bring this conversation when there are so many conversations coming up? If I fail, I understand. Failure is completely understandable. But not trying is something that you cannot live with. So that's when I started this journey. There were a lot of, negative experiences, but I would say learnings. There were times where people wanted to deprioritize. They couldn't say that this is not something that we'd want to do, but then it is something that could come later on. It is something that we could do on a case-to-case basis. But I did not want that to be there. Therefore, I started something called an employee resource group for LGBT plus people. Although we'd like to avoid the LGBT plus people words, just say, because we are having so many experiences from other marginalized people who are not able to talk about their experiences. Let me give you an example. Just a few days back, someone who is a single mother. She came out and she spoke about her experiences, how society looks at her as something completely different. And that is not very different from the general LGBT plus experience. Similarly, there are taboo subjects like sexual harassment, which people don't talk about at workplace. And all these things, they create a sense of fear, a sense of non-cohesiveness in a workplace. Once we started talking about this, they've released a sort of a latent energy which brings together a lot of people, which binds together them to the workplace, which binds them together to the place, to the society that they're in. So I think once we start these conversations, we will see, we can see just right in front of our eyes how much change we can bring about. One of the most happiest experiences that I had was that once I had started transitioning the workplace, there was a lot of gossip, there was a lot of talk. But then slowly I realized that the women at the workplace somehow found a lot of strength in their femininity at all. They could see that this person is ready to go for such lengths to find her femininity, to express her femininity. So why should not they? So from a manufacturing industry where even makeup was something that was sort of taboo. I mean, if you did too much of it, it was considered, you're not fitting in. I found people now who are coming in the best of their attire, be the best of themselves, come with the best of their ideas, and they're bringing the change in this organization. And that is what makes me extremely proud today.
Thank you. Thank you, Anu. And it's the same what Anupati is doing in the corporate world, and India and Akai have been doing with their respective NGOs, with Pratyay, with Ondede. For my next question, Akai, I want you to start off, because the changes that Anupati is bringing about have largely been facilitated by the fact of this recent 377 judgment. And for those of you who don't know, Akai was one of the petitioners for that judgment. So can we please thank you for creating a more equal India for all of us. So this is a critical juncture where we have people who are willing to change, post this judgment, post what we hope will be a good transgender rights bill. And, you know, at some point, if you all want to talk about when we are eventually going to get that bill. But what is the road ahead for trans women and trans people in India? And more importantly, at this juncture, please tell everyone here in this room and those who are watching online what they can do to join us on this road to create a more inclusive India.
I think India is a diverse country. We have seen three verdicts on Section 377. The 2009 July 2nd was a historical. It's not historical. His is in context to man. Her historical, what is in context to women. It's her historical judgment by the Delhi High Court delivered consenting sex between consensual adults is not, it's not punishable in privacy matter. Same 11, 12, 13 judgment, what happens? The Supreme Court has disrespected human sexuality and said, no, Delhi High Court judgment is unacceptable. What happens later then? The Constitution Bench recently delivered, exactly after Gauri Lankesh's assassination of 1 year remembrance, very next day the verdict came and the judgment said, no discrimination on the grounds of sexuality and gender. We talk about human sexuality and that's a total violation under the constitutional rights. It's not about verdicts. I think the judiciary has delivered such a historical verdict in its legitimization of the judiciary. And how do you bring a public morality? I know I am part of socialism, I am part of secularism country, but my country has never taught me to practice violence or communal violence. And sexuality, I think my Rama was part of sexuality, my Krishna was part of sexuality, my Jesus was part of sexuality, my Allah was part of sexuality. I think the human, it's called the human interpretation is such a negative way, but people are wanting to just dominate the power and patriarchy. Well, I am against it. And human sexuality is something that we need to accept the way people are. Why did the Supreme Court took so many years, centuries to deliver a very small line judgment? There are so many friends who gave up their lives, where your society killed my people. Your society assassinated my community. Nowhere of our reason, because of our sexuality and gender, why you took that authority to kill us? I think that is one side. But if you go back to the larger historical movement activism, people are in streets for each and everything. From bread, butter, housing, clothing, education, employment, my marriage, my privacy, my sexual performances. Always, I think the society has a problem in India, I feel so. Because the society, no, if you wear skirt, there is a problem. Short hair, there is a problem. Big boobs, there is a problem. How though? Small penis, sir, what is it? Small boobs also a problem. How do I combat my society, yeah? Stop society. That's your business to take your own way of thinking the notion of patriarchy. But according to myself, I'm not worrying about society. I am the society. I decide for myself. I decide my gender. I decide my sexuality. I think the way forward of the movement is, when you ask this question, I think it is not only the sexual minorities movement responsibility. I think it's now, it's a social, it's a global responsibility that you need to speak about these words of sex, gender, sexuality. Sex is not so madivantikeya. It is three letter, one beautiful, you know, like word. It's an art. Try, perform, curiosity. We do it and we don't speak it. What is the so hell in that so-called privacy? And privacy is not the four walls. If dark space is my privacy, that is a privacy. Because working class sections, I come from working class background, I know what is privacy means, you know? And the same context, what is gender? Gender is not the social construct based on a penis and vagina. If your beard, mustache, masculinity, and the structure, patience, voice, you know, it's not that. Gender is what I decide for myself, that is my gender. Sexuality is not only about penis, vagina, having sex for procreation. I think the movement has so much of resistance and we fight against that. Sex is about something that it's an intimacy. How do you understand combating the power? How do you take an active role? It is not about man dominating sexual performance. How do also women take part in that? I think this is something unspoken and my society wants it. I think transgender protection rights bill. At the same time, why my prime minister was so silent? When Supreme Court, utmost constitution bench, gave a judgment which has not excluded my prime minister. Why so silent? Not even a courtesy message as a prime minister of the state? Just silent. Silent, break your silence. I want my prime minister to speak on the human sexuality agenda. Let me educate him. Let me educate him. Let me educate him. Let me educate him. If you are, don't have any awareness about sex, gender, sexuality, please come to us. We will teach you. We will teach you. I think my country, my society needs not the bill. Not the verdict needs to be implemented. My only concern is that the society I need is that eradicate discrimination. Have a just society that the way we are wanting to live. Ashte, how do you build a movement of solidarity and support? Ashte.
Thank you. Anindya.
You see, I was having this conversation with you, I think, or with Anubhuti. 20 years ago, when we were also beginning our lives, we didn't have words like transgender. We didn't know what to call our experiences. Words are very powerful tools for us. We didn't have them. Oh, in the course of these two decades and slightly more, words were supplied, we found out, we discovered, we created our words, we created our worlds, we created our politics. Back then, we were fighting boxes. Now that there is a greater articulation on these issues, we are finding ourselves being boxed up. We are finding ourselves being put in these neat little boxes which you can't transcend. Many a times I hesitate to call myself a trans woman. I use the word trans person because I don't want to enter a box by breaking one before. So it's constantly juggling with these thoughts and thoughts. One thing that I want to sort of definitely say is that transgender people are not a monolithic category. You can't stereotype us. We are as diverse as anybody else in this room. So that is a very important takeaway that needs to be there. I also feel that there is also there are various intersections. There are intersections of caste. There are intersections of class. I mean, talking about sexuality, very often in this country, we do not talk about caste, we do not talk about class, we do not talk about religion. How does it make my situation precarious by being a Dalit trans person who's working class, who's probably Muslim? I mean, these are intersections, these are realities that we need to connect with and we need to talk to. So we are not like, and not all of us prefer wearing saris, though most of us in this panel are wearing saris. But point is, that's one stereotype we need to get out of our head. Affirmation is key. If you can't do anything, please do not take away our agency to speak for ourselves and be who we are. I think that's very, very fundamental. And also, and I've been wondering since the Section 377 judgment came, just because the Section 377 judgment came, there is no guarantee that the feminine boy in the school would not be bullied. And I think that I want to connect it to issues of trans people's empowerment, if I may, that there are, in our study, there are two fundamental things that have come out. One is this whole question of education, where trans people or people who do not fit the binary, who do not fit into these boxes, are pushed out of the education system just because of sheer ragging and bullying in schools. So where do they go? How do they sort of acquire skills? Where is the education for them? You know, we are fortunate. Many of us have been able to complete our education, but there's a great deal of people who haven't been and then have, you know, fallen behind in life in other ways. One is education. The other is mental health. So many of us have such huge mental health issues, primarily because what Anubhuti is saying is it the question of the wrong body or is it the question of the wrong society? I certainly feel it's the latter, because it is deeply set prejudices that one is sort of fighting. I think these, I would say, are messages, if you ask me.
Or a list for an agenda that we can all work on. Together with the rest of everyone else here in this room and online as well, right? One of the reasons why we do We the Women is for solidarity and for connection, for us to really recognize and feel empowered by the fact that this is a movement that is building and we can together create, we are the society, Akai, as you said, we can create the ideal society in which we want to live in.
I think in terms of philanthropy, and especially where corporate philanthropy is concerned, please put your money where your mouth is. I mean, I think this is something that you've been trying to do, Parmesh, for such a long time. And it's very important, as much as we have corporate social responsibility grants, funding, I think it should really, if there's a corporate body that's funding education and building schools, please also nuance that action by incorporating disability, by incorporating trans people or gender non-binary people, participation, girls. So many girls drop out when they reach puberty because there's no menstruation health management in schools. I think we really need to look at a cross-sectional world. And that's very, very important as a trans person.
Thanks, Anandya. Anubhuti?
Yeah, I'd like to put a little bit of different spin on that and also a very personal spin on that. This was something that I was discussing with Parmesh and Anindya this morning. What Anindya said is that trans people, since we've been fighting for our identity for so long, we've put ourselves in these boxes. Now, bringing the Section 377 judgment, like taking out what is in essence a talk of sexuality, let's talk now about the love experiences of trans people. I say this because I very recently fell in love with a person I rose in love with a person because that is exactly how I feel. It is a woman, it is a cis-identifying woman, and there is this tendency of associating trans women to being attracted to males. Now that is something that probably at some point of my life I also thought would be the norm, but now I find out that love is not something that identifies gender. Love does not identify your transition. It is who you are and who you are in love with. And if the person who you are in love with raises you in love, raises you as you are, that would be the happiest example for anybody. The reason why I say this is because, well, part of my attire is this Aanchal. The person I'm in love with, she's a fan of ghazals. There's this famous line by Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, which says that, "Mere dil ka kya khayal rakhoge jab ye Aanchal tumse sambhal nahi paata." So I don't think I'm doing a very good job with the Aanchal right now, but I hope I do a good job with the dil. So that's why I wanted to say that.
That's so beautiful and so romantic. Aur lunch ke pehle aapne rula diya thoda. But going back to Anandya's checklist, if we may, and also link to what the work that you are doing, it's so vital. Anandya, in your opening comments, you spoke about 92% according to the National Human Rights Commission, right? This is 92% of trans people are unable to participate in any economic activity. Not unwilling, unable. This is even when qualified, jobs are not given. And a lot of the work in diversity and inclusion, as you were talking about, as Anupati was saying, with Tata and other group companies, looks at LGBTQI with a very small focus on trans. So just to give you a sense, in a lot of companies, and you know, I work at Godrej, we're part of this journey with so many other companies. Everyone is looking at LGBTQ benefits. Very few people have gender transition policies, for example. They will have same-sex partner benefits, but not gender transition policies. So even over there, just what do you feel is necessary for not just companies? I would say, you know, the government with Kochi Metro, for example, which is a government agency which created jobs. Anyone who wants to create economic opportunities as a road for growth, what do you think these organizations, NGOs, companies, colleges, schools, institutions can do to be trans inclusive?
You see, I think, yeah, I missed out. There are so many things that one can flag. I think there is a question of the safe working environment. Everybody needs a safe working environment. A working environment that is affirmative, a working environment that does not discriminate, a working environment that does not sexually harass you for who you are, whether you're a cis woman, whether you're a cis man, whether you're a trans man or woman, or however you may identify. I think there's also this question of being supportive and extending that support in cases where trans people are transitioning, whether it's a question of sanctioning leaves. There can be a discussion on how the company can support her or his transitioning costs, as companies often pick up tabs for their employees' medical bills. There is a whole genre, there's a whole window of opportunity that the companies can actually open for trans persons. I think what is also important is to recognize that the change that trans people are bringing in, I mean, the question of diversity, the question of gender non-binary-ness that gets into the workplace is also opening up a space for gender equity. I mean, we all talk about equality, but I think what we're really talking about is equity. And equity not just in the share stockbroking sort of sense, this is real equity. And how do you sort of connect that with the intersection that I just spoke about? I mean, you need to bring in that lens in the corporate sector. What about insurance, for example? I mean, many things, for trans people's health rights, transitioning is not covered under insurance. I think that's also something that we need to probably look at.
I'd add to that, yes, it is very important that workplaces get their basics right for transitioning. A leave for a surgery is absolutely a must. Covering of costs are absolutely a must, because it is just something that you have to go through. It's a normalized process. But not only that, it has to be even, has to go further than that to understand the nuances of person who is going through a transition or who has gone through a transition. Now, I know a lot of trans people miss out on parts of their education, miss out of parts of their skilling, miss out on performing to the best of their abilities because of the dysphoria that they're facing, because of the discrimination that they're facing at their workplaces. Now, if organizations don't recognize that, if they just get the policies right and nothing else, it will not be a trans-inclusive organization. Organization has to start becoming positively discriminating by understanding the obstacles that a trans person faces. There are trans people who are extremely enthusiastic, who are extremely energetic, but they do not have a degree, they do not have that certification from a certain degree or a certain university, and that completely disqualifies them from being able to, unable to participate in the economy generation of the country. Now, if that continues to happen, if that sort of, when we talk about equality in chances, we cannot talk about equality in experiences. Trans experiences are very different. I myself can say that I had a lot of thoughts of not going for a higher education because I just did not want another degree in the same name that I had, which I wanted to get rid of so bad. So at any point, at any level of privilege that you are, there is always going to be factors which hold you back. For organizations to be completely respectable to you, they have to understand these nuances. And it is, I think, people like us, if we start going back to our organizations and talk about these nuances. We have this wonderful UN document which says what should be the basics we should start with. But then the nuances will be built by conferences like these, by places where we speak out and people can understand what we go through. So that is my perspective of how an equitable organization can be built.
Thanks, okay.
I think in my context, no. See, I want to speak the practicality. Yeah. There are two things happened in recent past judgments. 2014 was a transgender rights judgment saying that transgender are equal citizens before the constitution, referring us as third gender. I am still searching who is first gender, who is second gender, who is third gender. How the la? And very soon after the 2018 judgment about Section 377, I think now the public, the whole society has a huge amount of awareness that needs to be brought to all sectors, etc. But how do we do that? Who is a Koti? Who is a Jogappa? Who is a Marladi? Who is a Shiv Shakti? Who is a lesbian? Who is a gay? Who is a bisexual? Who is a pansexual? Who is a demisexual? Who is a asexual? So who speaks this? Who speaks this? I think there are so many friendly laws for who are born with cis female, cis male identities concerned in the country. But how does the mechanism of implementation is there? Same thing with my scheduled caste, scheduled tribe communities, SCST community. There's so much friendly laws. There are commissions. How much of mechanism that we're talking about the effective implementation part? Same thing that will also apply to the sexual minorities movement. I think the only demand is that, and the Karnataka state policy is such a beautiful policy across the nation. I think the government should take it very seriously. At the same time, you also has that responsibility. We cannot only dump on the government. Government is just the politics here. They want all the high-five positions, sit and do all the dhamaka styles of politics. But we are not supportive for that. But how do you, implement this whole process of humanity and social justice is through policies. What my colleague Anindya said, and also talk about these commission. The commissions should be in effective manner with so much of power. The commissions cannot be directed by the politics or the politicians. At the same time, how do you put the majority numbers who are from the grassroots section, working class sexual minorities, to dictate or to educate this whole society in that context?
Just to probably, yes. If I have half a minute, I want to sort of flag this thing that, like you were mentioning, the 92% that we talk about who have no opportunity to perform in any sort of economic activity, There is a great deal of transgender persons working in the factories, in the smaller establishments. In our study, we found that the trans people perform is part of the invisible informal economy. In this research that we were doing in Jharkhand, we found out that at some point about 30, 40 years ago, there was a Hijra unit, an Adivasi Hijra unit that used to sort of work in Tisco. So in the steel manufacturing unit. But these histories are undocumented. This labor is invisibilized. Still today, there's a large section of the domestic labor community, a lot of trans people are there within the community. That labor is completely invisibilized. Coming back to policy, I just also wanted to flag, recently, though it's much debated, the labor laws in the country are sort of being rationalized. Of course, there's a lot of contestation to that process of rationalization. And there was a suggestion by the Ministry of Labor to look at trans specificities. And I think the nuances that Anubhuti is talking about is to bring about these specificities of our communities. But interestingly enough, a year ago, the law ministry shot it down. They said there is no need to look at the trans specificities, etc. So the question is, like, what is the state saying? I mean, how is your labor, how is your body, how is your experience being constantly, you know, curtailed and being shut down and invisibilized?
And as you're speaking, I see such deep links between everything we've heard from the beginning, right, of this conference, whether it's Mithali talking about equity, whether it's the panels on Sabarimala and FGM. I'm seeing these linkages, right, coming up, and we're going to see these linkages throughout, accompanied by acts of resistance, accompanied by different ways of seeing. I want to wrap up and then maybe with time allow for one or two audience questions. But as a final question, we have so many trans icons in our mythology, in our history. But I want to ask you about contemporary icons for each one of you. I mean, we've all heard about our, you know, historic or mythological icons. Tell us about your contemporary. Do each of you have a trans feminist icon? And if so, tell us.
I'm sharing the stage with my trans feminist icon, Akkai Padmashali.
Any others?
In many ways, of course. I mean, the large numbers of trans women, invisible trans women and trans men who are leading struggles, nameless, faceless in this country. I also admire Poolan Devi for her guts to be who she is as a Dalit woman, as someone who had the guts and the power to challenge the system. Yeah.
Thank you, Anubhuti.
For me, it is someone who, I don't know if many of you have heard of them. They like to use the pronoun them. It is Alok Vaidmenon. What I like about what Alok Vaidmenon does is to bring out that bodies don't define us. The restrictions that we put on what a trans woman should be, what trans femme, what trans men should look like, are something that need to be challenged. As I said, we are not in a wrong body, we are in the wrong system. So it's the system that we need to upend. And if there is no one who stands up to the face of it and looks around and talks to people and is visible, we will not have these conversations going on. And the second thing I absolutely love about them is that they network. They network like crazy. They go around the entire world. They speak about their poetry, their spoken word, their all the experiences of trans people that they've had. And what this does is what this is something that all trans people or people who do not belong to a gender binary or even sexuality need to start doing. You need to start networking like crazy. You need to start finding positive discriminating places so that they become your allies and they become the agents of change of the society.
Thank you.
For me, the icon is Akkai Padmashali.
Thank you so much. Do we have time for maybe one or two questions from the audience?
If particular help from certain do you find that, you know, people who have served the country, the Tatas and the Godrejis, have a slightly more, humane outlook towards giving people a fair chance in life? Since so many of you seem to have mentioned that, you know, you say you're Godrej, somebody said they're Tatas, and, you know, these are corporates that have served the country and served the country well, and I think they're being kind of sidelined now. Do you find that certain corporates have a slightly better attitude towards human living and human living index than some others?
Anubhuti, can I take a stab
absolutely.
At that first?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think the hotel that which you are in right now, Lalit, is very, very interesting. You're going to hear from Keshav later on in the evening. But, you know, Keshav has been on this amazing journey. Over the past 2 years itself, I believe the Lalit across India has hired about 30 trans people at all their properties. And this is just the beginning. Now, the Lalit is not listed. It's in compared to the bigger hotel chains, right? It's not as well known. But this push is certainly being is really taking it to the next level. And more importantly, what the Lalit does is it places trans people in very visible positions. So at the reception, right in front, not on some call center or etc. It's saying that, you know, it's truly inclusive in that sense. So just, you know, one example could be the Lalit group. And
Talking about the Tatas, as Anindya mentioned very correctly, is that around 20 years back there was a unit of tribal trans women who were part of the workforce, who are part of the workforce, some of them are still. At that point of time, the discourse was not about transgenderism per se. At that point of time, a policy was brought about called the HIV/AIDS non-discrimination policy. It was a time when HIV/AIDS was quite rampant in the trans and larger LGBT communities, and the Tatas were, you know, they were sensitive enough to bring this, to understand this. Maybe the words, the LGBT plus policy is coming right now, but then to have an HIV/AIDS policy back then, to be in touch with the organization, with the community, is something that I find is extremely empowering. I find this because a lot of corporates, especially MNCs, are trying to hire trans people. What we are having is that there are a lot of trans people trying to join our organization. It is for us to skill them. It is for us to give them a position in a society that they would be proud of. An example that I'd share is that very recently we recruited 3 trans people in our blue collar workforce. One of them, she was actually thrown out of her family because she was a trans woman. Now she has a job with Tata Steel Tisco. Now she has a house, or people have quarters. So now she has a house in which to stay in, and now her family is very glad to accept her because now they have a roof to live under because of her. So these are the kind of things which happen.
Can I add something to that question? Just sure. Because the government is the biggest employer in the country. Has the government done anything for trans women?
The Supreme Court talks about reservations, in jobs, education. It's not implemented. There are no reservations for trans people in the area of work. So the role of the government is actually quite suspect in terms of what they try to bring in terms of a draft bill, supposedly a transgender rights protection bill. But looking at the bill, which we all protested, we were all in the streets and we stalled it. The bill was actually a transgender person's discrimination bill. I mean, the way, the wordings, the unscientific ways in which they define trans people, the way it actually sort of forwarded more prejudice. So no, the government has not done anything.
Yeah, can we take one more, maybe? The last question, though, yeah. Maybe in the, I think, yeah.
Hello, my name is Shivani. It's glad to see you all, you know, speaking out the heart out. So Unless the government, verdicts some policy or something, we don't accept anything in this country, right? And for you people, the confidence, it is just shunned by the people. And to be very frank, you're not accepted. Unless this 377 was decriminalized, I mean, yes, you got my point, I guess. So I just want a tip. How do you, just carry your confidence with you and the fights?
I'm just going to stop there.
It's very simple.
You want to respond? Yeah.
The self-confidence, the self-esteem, the self-acceptance, and the self-love. Ashte.
I know you are very well-meaning, but I don't think there's a connection between whether the government validates something and us, right? The government is in power, I mean, at the state, in the center, governments keep on changing.
My only thing is that, who is the government to decide my identity, yeah? Government needs to follow what I say, not what government says I need to follow. That is not my principle, that's not my value, and that's not my ideology.
And just so that you get it right, the 377 judgment spoke about constitutional rights that the Constitution of India had anyway granted us. We had those rights. The Supreme Court reinforced those rights. No one gave us any new rights. They just reinforced the rights that of a constitution which the great Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar had written for us and which was not being followed for 72 years. That's one thing. We self-validate ourselves. And the other thing is also... Again, I think this understanding of if you just go out and work with communities, you'll realize all of us work in families, we have workplaces, there are large social spaces. Queer India is actually, even if you look statistically, 5 to 10% of any population is LGBTQ, which means if assume we have 1.2 billion in India, I think it's a little more. You're talking about, at least 60 to 120 million queer Indians. Who are already out there. So my plea to you is to go out there and, make new friends, widen your horizon. And I think that's something to all of us. If we are looking at this conference, see the dots that connect right from the first session of Saxophone Subbalakshmi to the last, where you're going to hear Shabnam Mirani and the Blank Noise, and just see how all these dots connect. And just go on this wonderful journey. I want to thank my panel for being here. Thank you so much. We are going to continue to transform your lives. Yeah, feel free to stand up and put all of this online. I stand up as well. Thank you. Thank you all.